because we talked about everything already, but I thought I'd just do it in one shot. We'll start and we'll finish. The journey of sperm from testes all the way through the ejaculation. And there's a simple memory jogger to help you memorize, well, the major structure, seminae. Seminiferous tubule, epididymis, vas deferens, ejaculatory duct, and is nothing, but then UP, urethra, penis. Okay. Now all the details left out of 7-up I'm going to go through. Again, you start here. That's where the sperm developed. Testes, epididymis. Here it is cut open. If you just reduce it down just to the male ducts, the seminiferous tubules, that's just a sectional view. You have the lobules, which contain seminiferous tubules. I like this picture because it just shows the seminiferous tubules and these little lobules. So that's where the journey of sperm begins. I just been saying sperm. Spermatocyte is the full term. So in the testes, the lobule has the seminiferous tubule. You may have 1,000 seminiferous tubules in the testes. It's very convoluted, about 30 inches long. Notice how as you go this way, it becomes straight. These have these straight tubules, which lead into this net-like structure called the rete testes. To get out of the rete testes, the sperm must swim through something like 10 to 20 efferent ductyles to get out of the testes into the epididymis. Remember, efferent means coming out, leaving. And you'll go from there to epididymis. First the head, then body, then tail. Head, body, tail. About 20 feet long. It is continuous with the vas deferens. Or ductus deferens. The epididymis is about 20 feet long. The vas deferens is about 18 inches long. It's much shorter. This is the tube you snip to sterilize a male. Because you're outside of the body cavity, it's easy to do. You can do it in a urologist's office without being admitted to the hospital. But if you're not sterile, this will continue on. It'll go through the inguinal canal that we talked about, through the inguinal canal. After you go through the inguinal canal, you're going to go over the bladder. You're going to end up behind the bladder to the ampulla of vas deferens. Then you go inside the prostate to the ejaculatory duct. And that's, well, all the things I've said up to here, I defined in class earlier as the second E, which is what? Emission. Because after ejaculatory duct is urethra penis. Okay. You have the three parts of the urethra, which is, I'll just put urethra. The first part is the prostatic urethra. Membranous is the second part. Because you're piercing the UG diaphragm. The diaphragm is mostly a muscle. the deep transverse perineal is what I said. But anyways, this part of the urethra goes through there, membranous urethra. And then most of it is the penile or spongy urethra inside the corpus spongiosum. Now the spongy urethra, the tip of the glans penis, is the external urethral orifice, and that's officially the end of the male duct system. Then you're out of the male. External urethral orifice. So that's just a list of the structures to take yourself through. Let's look at the picture some more. This is showing you a sectional view with blood vessels. This is showing you just the ducts. This is showing you sterilization of the male. If you cut and ligate, cut means cut, ligate means tie off. Technically, you're sterile. This is outside the body cavity. Basically a vasectomy. But if you're not sterile, sperm will swim all the way through the inguinal canal behind the bladder. If I label it here, don't call it vas deferens. You should be more specific. Ampulla of vas deferens. Notice 1, 2, 3, we have seminal glands that contribute to the semen volume. This is the most important tube. It has the sperm. Then you have to go inside the prostate. Right here, that's the ejaculatory duct. You get to the urethra, come out. So the tip of the glans penis is the external urethral orifice. But let's mention the other accessory sex glands. Okay. When the word accessory is used, that means it's not a part, it's not within the duct here, but it empties into the duct. Okay, it's an accessory to it. So let's talk about three glands that contribute to semen volume. Three accessory glands that contribute to semen volume. The typical ejaculate is about 3 to 5 mils. That's how much semen you have in the typical ejaculate, and the most important thing is the sperm. About, I said earlier, 20 to 100 million sperm per mil. Okay. But, you know, if you're sterile, people ask, well, are you going to have ejaculate? Yeah, just from these other three glands. Just won't have the contents of the male duct system. But they are prostate. Seminal vesicle. Bulbourethral gland. Seminal vesicle contributes the most semen volume, about 60%. And the rest is by the other two. The bulbourethral gland contributes the smallest. And they're right here. Prostate, seminal vesicle, bulbourethral gland. Once again, prostate, seminal vesicle, bulbourethral gland. Let me use the app to show you these glands. It might enhance a little bit. There's the seminal vesicle highlighted in green. Don't confuse it with ampulla of ductus deferens, because they're right next to each other and they share EJ, ejaculatory duct. So notice how, let me zoom in a little bit to emphasize my point. The seminal vesicle and the ampulla of ductus deferens share ejaculatory duct. Shares EJ, ejaculatory duct, with ampulla of vas deferens. So the seminal vesicle, along with the prostate, the prostate gland will empty their secretions into the prostatic urethra. Okay? Highlighted in green. Write that down. Seminal vesicle and prostate. Empty into prostatic urethra. Because there's a seminal vesicle and the prostate literally surrounds the prostatic urethra. Okay. There's one more gland. I'm going to zoom back out. This part of the root of the penis, what is it called, this part at the root? It's the corpus spongiosum. It's the bulb. Therefore, next to the bulb, look for a little gland called bulbo-urethral gland. Let me highlight it. It's a little P-shaped gland. Let me zoom out a little. There it is right there. It's emptying into this first part of the spongy urethra. So look for the gland next to the bulb of the penis, and it empties into the spongy urethra. Empties into spongy urethra. So this is what the picture looked like when we were studying it from a posterior view. Alright. Identify. Seminal vesicle. Prostate. Bulbo-urethral gland. If you use our keys, they call it Kalpers. That's another name you can use. It's slightly easier to spell. Bulbo-urethral gland, also known as Kalpers. You want to use that term. I call it seminal vesicle. Sometimes they just call it seminal gland. That's fine too. Let's go back to the PowerPoint slide right there. Here's the picture. Here's a model that looks like that picture, the posterior view of the bladder. Here we got two things right next to each other. What if I put it more here? What are you going to put?
Seminal vesicle.
I'll put it more right there. That's ampulla. It's clearer on the other side. Prostate. I don't see the bulbo urethral gland model. Okay, here's another posterior view. This one contains the whole urethra. Okay, now, zoom in. You can see the opening of something. The ejaculatory duct empties right there. It's the prostatic urethra, membranous part, and then the spongy urethra there. If this is the opening of ejaculatory duct, what are these the openings of, these two little things? For these guys, what are these little P-shaped things? Well, right there. Bulbo-urethral gland, all right? Again, look for them next to the bulb of the penis, where this would be. The red arrow is pointing to the same thing, opening of the ejaculatory duct from a sagittal view or from this view here, what we just looked at. All right, so those accessory glands, I do want to talk about some of their contents. Let's talk about the prostate and what it secretes. The secretion of the prostate is a milky, acidic secretion. And the most important thing to help along the journey of the sperm is citrate, which the cell will need for metabolism, the sperm. All these things are a supporting staff for the sperm. Okay. I also put that the prostate contracts during ejaculation. It's fibromuscular. The seminal vesicle contributes about 60% of semen volume. It's a thick yellow alkaline fluid. Okay, I already told you it shares the ejaculatory duct. You need the citrate for the citric acid cycle, but you kind of want to neutralize the acidity. So seminal vesicle secretes an alkaline fluid. That means basic. Now, the bulbo-urethral gland, the secretions are thick, alkaline, clear mucus. Basically, it's going to neutralize the trace urine that may be in the spongy urethra. So it's an alkaline mucus. That neutralizes trace acid. Urine. Now there's other things in the semen. Most notably the sperm. I already gave you that figure. There's fructose in there. There's prostaglandins. There's a relaxant that increases sperm motility. Well, it's all just listed here for you. There's an antibacterial agent. There's fibrinolysin. I mean, you could kind of look at the slide and list those things. The basic idea is everything there is to support the sperm, the ejaculate, once it leaves the body here in the female reproductive tract, to fertilize the egg. If ovulated, it's caught by the distal end of the uterine tube. So fertilization, ejaculation may occur here in the fornix, which is the junction of vagina and cervix. It's got to swim all the way down. Okay. I've read that sperm can swim from there to there for fertilization in 5 minutes. If the egg is there, it's going to get fertilized. Of course, when is the egg going to be there? You got one shot in a month, right? The day you ovulate, which is typically day 14 of a 28-day cycle for a female. So let's move to the female reproductive system. Is there any questions on male?
Which structure within the spermatic cord conducts the spermatid?
Vas deferens. Any other questions? Well, I'm opening up the female slides. I kind of start with the sagittal section, like the sagittal section for the male we started with. I have this picture here too, which is basically a hysterectomy. You've removed all the female reproductive structures. You isolated them. Here's the mid-sagittal section for the pelvis. It's got everything you need to see here. I mean, pay no attention to the bladder or the rectum. The bladder is anterior, the rectum is posterior. Do you see how the uterus is flexed over the bladder? There's kind of an angle here with the vagina. Let me use the app to introduce some of these ideas here. So we'll go to female. So here's the female reproductive system using the app. The rectum isn't in the picture, but what's that? The urinary bladder, and here you have the uterus flexed over it, and then there is the vagina there. So and the ovaries remain in the lateral pelvic wall for the female. For the male, I said there's the three E's for male reproduction. For female reproduction, I call it the three receives, quote unquote, for female anatomy. Female repro anatomy. Be familiar, as you study the anatomy, keep this in mind. The three, quote unquote, receives. Basically, these are the three things I think are essential for the female to help humans reproduce. Number one, the first receive is the female must receive the ejaculate. Now, if we're at a high part of this wall here, let me see if I can do that. Hide that. If I open this up, this is the vaginal canal. That's the cervix, the first part of the uterus. Sperm has to swim up in there. There's a little recess between the cervix and the vaginal wall. It's called the fornix. During sex arousal, this fornix, it really expands and gets big. Okay, and that's where the ejaculate kind of pools during sex. So it must receive the ejaculate, but comma, which pools. Fornix just means recess, a space. This is the fornix between, it's by the cervix. cervix is the neck of the uterus, right? Cervix means neck. And basically, during sex, the cervix kind of gets out of the way. But then, after sex, it kind of will swoop down into the pool of ejaculate and then basically suck up the semen into the uterine cavity. So that's the first receives. But if you're going to reproduce, the second receives, that must happen on the same day as sex or the day before. Pull back. So I highlighted part of the ovary that has the egg. It must be ovulate. It must make a jailbreak. It must burst out of that structure. You see how this is kind of loosely connected to it? That's the uterine tube. It must catch it and be swept into there. If it doesn't catch it, it'll just fall into the peritoneum and go away. It's just a single cell, okay? The oocyte. So my second receives is during ovulation, the uterine tube must receive an ovulated oocyte. The uterine tube must receive an ovulated oocyte. That's the proper name for egg. In fact, you know, in tests, don't use egg. I don't like it. The anatomy word is, or the physiology word is oocyte. That's the name of the cell. Day 14 of a 28-day cycle. Typically, one per month about, okay? So, if a female has her period, her menstrual period, what do you know didn't happen? She's not pregnant, right? Because what is the menstrual discharge? It's the lining of the uterine wall. It's like you build it up, no pregnant, slough it off, start again. Okay, now what if you missed your period? What does everyone know? Oh, you're late, what does that mean? You're late. It means she might be pregnant. Okay? Why? Because you want to save that for the egg, for the fertilized egg. So basically, let's back up. It should have happened day 28. Oh, you're not pregnant. What happened 2 weeks earlier? You probably got pregnant. Okay? So on day 14, this bursts out of here, and it just waits there. It can hang out there for a day or two, waiting for sperm to fertilize it. If sperm does fertilize it, it can't stay there. It will fertilize it here. The typical site of fertilization is the ampulla of the uterine tube. Let me write that down. Typical site of fertilization where sperm meets egg, right, is the ampulla of the uterine tube. All right, great, so you fertilized. That happens on day one, you were conceived, right? The day you're conceived is fertilization. Happens right around here at the end of the tube. The third receive is, well, the uterine cavity must receive this fertilized egg. Turn the lights off. It's kind of hard to see it. There's a cavity inside here. It's not showing very well on the app. It's a thick wall of muscle, right? But it's kind of like implant here in the body of the uterus. So the first week of pregnancy, you're just a ball of cells. You're here, and you gotta like float into the uterine cavity and implant. You could implant here, that's not good. You'll never make it. It's called ectopic pregnancy, and you gotta remove that. You have to abort that to save the life of the mother, usually, okay? I mean, I've heard of cases where it's like the fertilized egg, it'll go over here, and weirdest case I heard was it implanted in the peritoneum by the iliac artery. And it's happy. It has a nice blood supply. That case went the full term. Okay? And it's like the baby grew in the abdominal cavity because it had blood supply. It happened to implant in that place. Normally you want it to implant here. So that's my third receives.
So what are the consequences of it actually just sitting in the ampulla?
What's that?
The ampulla,
so if it stays there?
Yeah.
As it starts to grow, that little tube can't accommodate a growing embryo, and all the blood vessels that are there will get strangulated, it could perforate, it's just not good.
So it's going to happen to the mom, is it?
To save the life of the mom, you have to abort that pregnancy. Okay? So it's essential that my third receives is the uterine cavity must receive the fertilized egg for implantation. That's where you want it to implant. Third, the uterine cavity must receive a fertilized oocyte for implantation. Implantation occurs about a week, week and a half after fertilization. Okay. Now, gestation, pregnancy, is about 38 weeks. But when a pregnant woman goes to the doctor, what's the first thing the doctor asks her? First day of the last period, because that's usually the thing a female can remember. Then what does the doctor do? He calculates 40 weeks from menses. Because the last time you had a period, you knew you weren't pregnant. So then you guys know you got pregnant the next cycle. Now, gestation is 38 weeks. The reason why they calculate 40 is because, well, you weren't pregnant on your last menses. You got pregnant 2 weeks later, right? You think. So that's why due dates are an approximation. But they're usually pretty close. All right, let me go back to pictures. So that's my three receives. You gotta like receive the ejaculate, receive an ovulated oocyte, the uterine cavity must receive the fertilized egg for implantation, for reproduction. So there's a blank figure that you can study. It's pretty good. They have everything you need to see. There's no scrotal sac. The gonads are in the lateral wall of the pelvis. See right there? There's a uterine tube, uterine cavity right there. There's the cervix. Okay, there's that fornix, right? That space really balloons up during sex. The cervix gets out of the way. There's the vagina to receive the penis. Remember, men have a vagina too. Vagina is just a word that means sheath. Okay, I have a labia here. Let's look at the perineal region in the female. Same thing, UG triangle, anal triangle. Here's the external genitalia there. Here's a dissected picture. Here are those two muscles you gotta know. The superficial, the deep transverse perineal. Let's look at the erector muscles in the female. Let me zoom in a little bit. For those of you that use the Atlas, page 261. So if you bought the Atlas, this is the time of the course you want to start bringing it. I didn't really use it much for endocrine, but as you can see, I'm using it a lot now. Erector muscles for the female, they have the same name, ischiocavernosus, right here. There's one there. The with the one on the other side. Ischio, because you remember the ischium, right? Muscle, or excuse me, bone of the hip bone, right? Ischium, whatever, cavernosum. Okay, this muscle in female wraps around the crust of the clitoris, which is erectile tissue, shown there. It's a muscle that wraps the crust of clitoris. So the clitoris is basically the female erectile tissue. So this muscle wraps the leg, so the crest of the clitoris. Here's the bulbospongiosus muscle, which remains open, right? So here's the bulbospongiosus. Here it's been dissected away, so you can see what it covers. It covers the vestibular bulb, which is erectile tissue. Spongiosis muscle that wraps the vestibular bulb. So the crust, the vestibular bulb, erectile tissue in females. What's the homologous structure in males for this bulb? Was there something called bulb in males? It was the bulb of the penis. So this is like the bulb of the penis in females, the homologous structure. So you got two of them, one here, one here, okay? So do you see how the bulb, the vestibular bulb, the crust, and here's the glans clitoris, they're all connected. Okay, that's the clitoris. There's glands, crust, vestibular bulb, it's all clitoris, it's all erectile tissue. People mistakenly call the clitoris the female penis. It's correct in that it's erectile tissue, but it's incorrect in that, well, in the male penis, the urethra can convey urine and semen, but in the female, that's not the case, so I don't think it's a very good analogy. But know those muscles right here. So there's a gland here, it's not pictured there. This vestibular bulb, when it becomes engorged with blood during sex arousal, it compresses a gland called the greater vestibular gland, which then, when it's compressed, the gland will secrete its lubrication for the vagina during sex. Okay, so what I'm writing is vestibular bulb compresses the greater vestibular gland, not shown, which then secretes lubrication by the vagina. How long is that truck in the back of? That's not at some point. Well, anyways. Finally. See that pink structure? It's all clitoris. Clitoris, okay, glands, crust, right? Identify structure. Vestibular bulb. Vestibular bulb. What about that little thing next to it? This greater vestibular gland that will secrete into the vagina during sex arousal. Yeah. Okay. That's what I want to show you. The gland wasn't shown in that picture.
Yeah.
Thank you. Here's the external genitalia. This is the view of the obstetrician. You go to med school, become an obstetrician. I guess you see this every day. This is your life. This is the basically the perineal region, right? So the area of skin covered with pubic hair is called the Mons pubis. The hair from puberty, right? Pubic hair, and that's why the pubic bone of the hip got that name, because it's the bone of your hip covered with the skin that has pubic hair. If you look at the labia, you have labia majora, labia minora, two of each. The labia majora is basically skin with hair follicles. Labia means lips, majora means bigger, skin with hair follicles. Labia minora are smaller, and they're hairless. Hairless skin is basically what I'll say. The space enclosed by the labia is what they call the vestibule. Vestibule is a space, an entryway. So, vestibule. Space. Enclosed by labia. So, labia is a pluralized term because you have two. Have you ever seen the term, like, say, for example, labrum? Minus. But they're going for labia minora, singular form. Or something like that. But I usually just refer to it in pluralized form. So this is kind of the space, the vestibule is the space enclosed by the labia. It's in front of the vaginal orifice and the external urethral orifice. Okay, it's kind of in that region. The vaginal orifice and the external urethral orifice. Located within the vestibule. An older term for this area is called the vulva. I don't really use that term anymore, but I still see it. Vulva. It's basically the labia vestibule area that I just got through describing. I won't give you the details of it. But I like this picture of a model. It's labeled. So we can see, for example, the UG diaphragm, right? The UG diaphragm, the muscle of that is the deep transverse perineum. That thin band on this side or this side is the superficial transverse perineum. We see the erector muscles. We see the bulbal spongiosis. And we see the ischiocavernosis and the bulbal spongiosis. Right? It's hard to see, but they do have the greater vestibular gland there. All right, so they also show the labia and the clitoris. Here's our model, it's over there. I took this picture. This side they have dissected out the deep and superficial transverse perineal. Both of these heads are the ischial cavernosus. You can see a sliver of bulbous spongiosus muscle there. Okay. See labia majora, labia minora. If you have a superior view and you're looking down into the pelvis, if I remove all of the pelvic viscera, the organs, and you look at the floor, what you have are muscles of the levator ani. Okay, so we have to know the structures that support the reproductive structures here. So, pelvic floor muscles are pubococcygeus, iliococcygeus, coccygeus. Those are the three I'll remove. Pubococcygeus, iliococcygeus. Those first two, the pubo and the ilio, those are muscles from a group called levator ani. Part of the levator ani. The third muscle on the pelvic floor, not part of levator ani, coccygeus. When I have you know muscles in this class, I won't ask you the attachments or the action or the innervation. It's pretty much just identification. In terms of actions, these just support pelvic viscera. They support the reproductive organs for a female. It keeps, for example, the uterus from prolapsing down the vagina. They help prevent that. All right, so here's our model. It's half of a pelvis, right? And I have it labeled on the next slide, so maybe you could practice. You have pubococcygeus, there's the pubic bone. So the one running most medially here from front to back, pubococcygeus. Look for this white tendinous arch. That's my clue for finding the iliococcygeus. And then this one here is just coccygeus. And they're labeled ABC, 17, I think that's in 17C, B, A. Anyways, they're labeled. We have keys for them. So if we look at down here, I see the clitoris. This blue structure is the clitoris, so that tip is the glans clitoris. I see both labia, minor and the major. Okay, that's the urethra, that's the vagina. And so remember, the urethra and the vagina have to pierce that membrane, the UG diaphragm. The name of the muscle of the UG diaphragm is the deep transverse perineum. I've been saying it all morning. Okay, so anyways, that's the floor that supports the female reproductive structures. If we look at the ovaries, in a prepubescent girl, they would be smooth and pink. But usually in an adult female who's had many ovulations, they'll kind of be pustulated and scarred, because remember, what has to burst out of there every month? The egg, right? So with time, it kind of has a scarred appearance. Anyways, this picture, I want to use it to study the broad ligament, because that kind of shows you the relationship between the uterine tube and the ovary. So let me go back to the app for a second, let me come back to this picture. So I'm going to reset, it puts the broad ligament back on. So it's like you take a bed sheet and you drape it down over these structures and it covers everything, forming the broad lumen. Something I want you to see. Do you see how the uterus is flexed forward? But here are the ovaries. The uterus flexes forward. Here are the ovaries. The uterine tube reaches around back and kind of covers it to catch the ovulated oocyte. Here and here. Okay. Go back to the PowerPoint. I don't know if this is helping me any more than the picture would. Well, anyways, here is peritoneum covering the uterine tube. And it reaches down and it pinches in different places. So if you look at this picture, this little inset, this picture here is generated by cutting through uterine tube and ovary right there. Okay. So your eyeball is like looking from this view here when you look at that picture, right? And so I use this figure to teach the three parts of the broad ligament, the peritoneum that covers the reproductive structures and the pelvis. Is basically the broad ligament is peritoneum that covers, and then supports female reproductive structures. And there's three parts to the broad ligament. The first part is this double pinching here. Wraps around the uterine tube, but the part that pinches just inferior to the uterine tube is called mesosalpinx. So meso refers to this broad ligament. Mesosalpinx. Salpinx means trumpet. I guess someone thought the uterine tube looked like a trumpet. Okay, notice how the peritoneum wraps around the ovary, and the part of the peritoneum that pinches above the ovary is the mesovarium. So it's just superior to ovary, whereas the mesosalpinx is just inferior to uterine tube. Okay, and this part here, it's going to be this right there, the lateral part of the uterus. That's called the mesometrium. It provides lateral support to the uterus. The largest part of the broad ligament. Provides lateral support to uterus. Let's see if I can show you those three things in the app. It makes it a little clearer, I think. The part that's highlighted now is showing you the part over the uterine tube and just this part just inferior to it. So that is mesosalpinx. Okay. So then what's this in green? It's the mesovarium. right? The part that pinches just above the ovary. Here's the uterus right there. So I'm gonna highlight that. What do you think that's gonna be? Yeah, the mesometrium. It covers the rest. Okay, so those are the three parts of the broad ligament. And you have other ligaments that support the ovary, but I just want you to see that and look at it on this picture now. Let's look at this model that we have in the room. It's a picture of the uterus. Let me leave the light off while I kind of show you here. It's the only one that kind of shows all three parts pretty clear. So this whole thing is the uterine tube, and they cut away the broad ligament there. But if I tag it right there, and I'm going for the mesosalpinx, there's a little bend there. If I tag it right there, I'm going for mesomerium, and then that's mesometrium. So that shows pretty good. All right, so those are the broad ligament supports the uterus. This picture, I want you to see how there are pouches in front of and behind the uterus. You don't have these in males because males don't have a uterus. But do you see how the peritoneum, it covers right here, and then it kind of also covers the bladder? So that pouch is the vesicouterine pouch. The peritoneum covering here and then covering this part of the rectum is the rectouterine pouch. So write those two pouches down. I want you to know those. So now the vesicouterine pouch. Vesico refers to bladder, right? A vesicle is a container of something. Obviously, uterine refers to uterus, so that pouch is basically between the bladder and the uterus. Now, behind the uterus, you have the rectouterine pouch. Rectum is behind the rectum is behind the uterus. If you cut the uterus open, you can see there's a cavity inside of it. So here it is, uncut. If we straighten it out and just kind of cut it open, we get a nice view of the uterine cavity inside. It's a very good picture to study. It has everything. You can see the uterine tube superior to the ovary. We can see how the vagina is associated with the cervix of the uterus. So the uterus is basically shaped like an upside down pear, and it has different regions. Is Latin for womb. It's where pregnancy occurs for 38 weeks after implantation. Or sometimes they call it gestation. The gestation occurs for about 38 weeks after the embryo implants. We'll go through that. But this is where it occurs. Let's just learn the anatomy of this organ. Okay. One region of the uterus is called the fundus. And again, always be complete. Say fundus of uterus. Fundus describes the part of the uterus you're talking about. It's the part you can palpate. It's the superior round part. Now, most of the uterus, they call the body. Okay. That's usually right there where they're pointing, in the uterine cavity is the body, but in the cavity there, that's where you want implantation to occur. Okay, right in the body. for the body of the uterus is the majority of it. Now, because it gets narrow, do you see the part where there's a constrictor? Right around there. They call that the uterine isthmus. Hard to say, isthmus. I-S-T-H-M-U-S. Isthmus is like narrow, the narrow passageway. Isthmus of uterus. Now, sometimes it's hard to find because they don't show the uterus constricted on a lot of the models. But the hint is it's always at the top of the cervix by definition. There's a little opening here called the internal os, and the uterine isthmus is always at the same level. Same level as internal os, OS. Os is opening. So the uterine isthmus is a line. It's not a big region, it's just a line where the uterus constricts. Everything below that, about the inferior one-third of the uterus, is all cervix. Okay. Cervix forms about the inferior one-third of the uterus. Now, the cervix is special. It's considered part of the birth canal, right? Because in birth, head first, the cervix must dilate about 10 centimeters to accommodate baby's head. If the mom does not ever dilate, maybe sitting there for a day or two, it's up to the obstetrician, the surgeon, they may decide, well, okay, we gotta go C-section, which is when they actually just deliver through the uterine wall, okay, instead of being delivered through the birth canal, a natural childbirth. So the cervix is the first part of the birth canal. Well, it's not too hard to guess what's the second part, vagina. And also part of the birth canal. So the cervical canal, which must dilate to 10 centimeters during childbirth, it's not illustrated like that here, but it's bounded by internal os, external os. You should know those structures. So you have the cervix, which is the whole thing, but the canal in it has a name. Just call it cervical canal. Let me continue up here. Cervical canal is bounded by the internal os and the external os. I think that's a good place to stop for today.